Yeah, I guess I am a Brony.
This week on Backward Compatible, in honor of its 30th anniversary, Jim, Doc, and Chris reflect on the legendary Super Mario franchise. Plus, our thoughts on Star Wars Uprising, the Angry Birds film, and Konami's departure from AAA game development. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. Welcome to episode number 45 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And our meaty topic for the day, in honor of the 30th anniversary of Super Mario, we are going to be talking about our experiences with Super Mario. But before then, we've got...
Super Mario?
Super Mario Bros.
I'm not aware of this series. Is this a pretty big deal?
Yeah, it's a fairly big deal.
Oh, okay. All right.
You know, we did that joke like 2 weeks ago.
Oh, yeah?
I'm reminded, actually, in Super Smash Bros. Brawl, there was a special stage because Snake guest starred in that one. And when you go to Snake's home stage, you could have a way to have Snake call on his codec different characters. And what they would do is tell you about the characters you're fighting. And so the one for Mario was interesting because it's like, Snake, do you know who that is? Of course, it's Mario. It's like, there are very few people who don't know Mario. He's that famous. So it was a funny little thing.
Hey, when you're a good plumber.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Word of mouth spreads. Yeah. So. Cool. But first, we got a few opening segments for you. But so let's go ahead and jump right into the button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
All right, button mosh. I know Chris and I have both been playing the same game these last couple of weeks.
Metal Gear Solid 5,
the Phantom Pain specifically.
Mm-hmm.
And I gotta tell you, I've been having a blast with this game. I am really loving the gameplay. I'm enjoying the story and the cutscenes too. I do think that initially there were some long cutscenes, but I actually liked the escape from the hospital part, the initial part, which I believe was put in, even though it's very different from the rest of the game, it doesn't have the open world element. I believe it was put in because it's sort of, there's that moment where you have to download a whole bunch of stuff, load the game and download all that. So you're able to play through a short mission.
Oh, that's takes about an hour. Yeah, yeah.
While it's doing that. Uh-huh. I mean, so that's, I think it was actually a pretty clever thing to put that in there.
Yeah,
what are your thoughts on the hospital mission?
I thought it was cool. It definitely is different from the rest of the game. In fact, you get deep enough into the rest of the game and you kind of forget about that sequence in a way. It feels like a very distant memory, which is actually kind of interesting as far as associating with the character as a player.
Right.
Yeah, but it was a really interesting sequence, very intense, you know, kind of, it has a very different feel and tone from the other Metal Gears, and so in that sense, expectation.
You're totally, you don't have all your weapons, you're like, you're wearing like a hospital gown. For most of it, you can't even walk, you can barely move because you just woke up from a coma, so you have to get like, you just get like magic drugs to kind of sort of like kind of try to walk, but you're still like, you're stumbling, you're falling over, for a long part of it, you're just sort of like dragging your legs and pushing against stuff, and really feel like you're so used to being this badass as Snake, and you're totally not. You are like this weak kitten, essentially. You're totally at the mercy of anyone around you. It's a very, very different way to approach
it. It builds empathy with the character.
Way to, you know, present boss.
Yeah. And it also serves as a tutorial sequence, too.
Of course.
It slowly, like, you get to a point where it kind of opens up a little bit in the sense that, okay, here's a room, how are you going to approach this? That sort of thing.
And you also get introduced to the cast of characters, some of, like, the weird characters that are always a part of Metal Gear games. Like, this time we've got the man on fire, who's this guy who's, like, just burning on fire, and he, like, for some reason, like, you can shoot him with bullets and he, like, absorbs them. You can shoot him with missiles, he absorbs them. But, of course, you know, he can't take water, so you have to find a way to, like, you know, douse him with water. And Kojima loves doing this stuff with boss fights. He always finds cool ways to do interesting boss fights. The other one was, you know, I recall the Psycho Kid or the Ginger Kid. She's kind of like Psycho Mantis, only a kid. I don't know if it's supposed to be yet. I don't know if it's supposed to be Psycho Mantis or if it's someone related to Psycho Mantis. But it's a kid with, like, red hair. You're not... It might be a girl, but I'm not so sure. It could just be a long-haired guy. I don't know. I don't know if it's really important.
It's a there's kind of like in Metal Gear Solid 4 too, there's a character that has a very Psycho Mantis sort of style.
Yeah.
And so it's like the proud lineage of, you know, psychic people with gas
but
masks floating.
But they're like telekinetic style, picking things up, and also one of the interesting things too is that you're also not really sure if they're actually telekinetic and doing this, or if it's they're messing with your perception of things. That's part of it. It's kind of supposed to be a little bit ambiguous there.
Yeah.
Just like when they have, you know, some big machine that you see in the mists that you never you find out what it is later on. Obviously, it's a Metal Gear, but you find out more about it later on.
Right.
And then of course Skullface. You get introduced to Skullface, who's sort of the main antagonist.
Mm-hmm.
He has like this, you know, scarred, nasty face, and he's got that little domino mask kind of thing covering his, you know,
which is funny because it's like, what identity are you trying to hide? Like, everyone who knows who you are knows you by your like gray, charred face.
Yeah. I'm sure that's a style thing,
stylistic choice,
of course. But it's very interesting, and into the game, I'm about 22 missions in, 25%, only 25% in, even though I've played about 44 hours, and that's because I've done so many side ops. I love the gameplay of the game personally. I love this open world, approach it from any way you want, take people out pure stealth in, never get caught, or go in guns blazing, call in your chopper to start shooting missiles at things, steal tanks and start driving them into something, steal like a jeep and pretend like you're one of their, you know, people just delivering something. All these different ways to approach missions. You can play a missions as Snake. You can use the characters that you've captured. That's the other thing. You're supposed to be building your base, your mother base, by Fulton extracting things. I love the Fulton extractor, which is just this little balloon you stick on people at first, but then you can put it on animals. Of course, your horse is on it, but also you can start putting it on vehicles and eventually tanks and like huge vehicles and stuff. You can just Fulton extract them. It's really neat. And then the boss fights. I mean, so far I've only had two true boss fights. Quiet, who's a great character. She's the female. It's got a little bit of flack for some of the skimpy options, people that don't play the game. But
we promise there is a reason for that.
There is actually. I don't know if we want to. Well, it's pretty early. I think maybe we could explain that reason.
Yeah.
And essentially the idea, and I think it's really cool. So she doesn't breathe, which is actually something that makes a lot of sense for it. It's beneficial for a sniper because if you don't have to breathe, you don't have that rhythm that it could mess your aim up when you're sniping. Not to mention you also get control people hearing you, because if you don't breathe, that means you don't have that, you know, stress breathing when you run, stuff like that. So the only noise that she ever makes is her humming if she wants to.
Yeah.
So she controls what you hear.
Mm-hmm.
Because she doesn't breathe, well, she has to respirate some way. She respirates through her skin. So the idea is that she doesn't want to wear too much clothing because she has to have her skin.
She'd be suffocating.
Right, she would suffocate herself if she wears all this clothing.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. I mean, obviously there's, you know, an element of they're trying to make her a sexy character, and it's part of Kojima's
style.
Some of the things I love about him is, you know, he can be kind of pervy, but he does create interesting female characters, and I think part of that, like, perviness that we say, it's part of that's a cultural difference and the way that he perceives. We can't also view everything through an American lens. I think it's a little unfair. But that being said, I understand people that say he could be kind of a perv, but he's also given us some great female characters. I think Quiet is another in a line of them, and I would definitely say the boss is one as well.
Yeah. Well, the other detail about that, too, is that she's photosynthetic, which is also extremely helpful for a sniper, because you can sit there for days and days and days fine. And so she heals herself, essentially, by getting water, and that's kind of how she's able to, you know, fuel the photosynthesis and that sort of thing.
Speaking of that, did you see her doing that during the quiet boss fight?
Yeah, she goes to the fountain and heals up a little bit.
That was like, I saw that and I was like mind blown. I saw that, I'm like, what in the heck is going on here?
Yeah, and until you find out the reason, it's like, why, what, how?
It was really, it was a cool moment because I saw it and she's had, and like all these lights and she's like frolicking in this water and like just like healing. I'm like,
it's like, yeah, we're not in the middle of a sniper fight. Yeah, no big deal.
I was too stunned to try to shoot her. I was just
I shot
stunned.
Her.
You did?
Yeah, I got a headshot in.
I couldn't do it. I saw it. I was actually stunned. I just was like watching this, like just mind blown. And then the other boss fight that I've done is Man on Fire, which I won't talk about because I know you haven't quite got it.
I've seen it. Like my brother's played all the way through the game, so I've been spoiled as to a few things, which I'm not mentioning certain things because you haven't gotten to that point yet. So, but once we both played it, we definitely plan to do a player codex entry where we do like a full on analysis of this game
and the series, where it's really going to be more of a retro, like a full retrospective, a full.
Well, there's going to be the retrospective episode, and then there's also going to be like, let's talk about Phantom Pain.
Oh, okay, you're right. I'm sorry. Yeah. And when we talk about Phantom Pain, I think it's more, we're going to talk about Metal Gear Solid 5 as a whole. We can also talk about some of the Ground Zeroes, which is the prologue. Sorry, Doc, we really went off on the game because we love this game so far.
I hadn't noticed by the fact that we've been talking about it for the last 2 hours since before we hit record.
Yeah, a game I haven't played
in a series I really don't like.
And that's fine. I mean, it's one of those, but it's not for everyone.
I want to be clear on this. Yes. I do support the injured veterans, which is clearly what this game is about, because the man has lost an eye and he's having phantom pain, and I think that's sad.
It actually that is a theme of the, I mean, I don't know if you were saying
that. Okay, stop ruining my
that is actually one of the themes of, you know, like soldiers and what they go through. I mean, the whole storyline behind what the boss, like what Big Boss stands for, is he's trying to create a sort of like a society for soldiers that is divorced from any sort of country in which they're not used as political pawns.
Wow, that's
so cute. He's trying to get to you know, because he knows that the way that soldiers are being abused, because basically that's what happens in Metal Gear Solid 3. You find out you've been essentially duped by the U.S. government and all of this, and
a particular branch. It's not necessarily a condemnation of like America itself so much as like this secret society that's kind of running things from the
office. It's also the it's complicit. I mean, he completely snubs the president when he goes to get his medal. If you remember,
I should have gone with my VA hospital joke while you were talking about hospital.
But no, I think.
Well, he doesn't snub the president. He snubs like one of the cabinet members.
No, no, he's there with the president, and he refuses to. He refuses to salute him.
I don't recall that bit.
At the very end, he walks into the room, and they salute him, and they give him all this stuff, and he doesn't, and he just turns around and walks away.
Huh. I'd have to rewatch the scene.
It's also Ford, I believe. Is it Ford? No. Right after. Yes, it would have been Ford, wouldn't it?
I forget who it was.
I know it was a president that wasn't elected. The important part of that was I've heard some fan theories say the reason he didn't salute him was because he wasn't an elected president. I think it was Ford.
This is Roleplay for Roleplay, the mechanics of tabletop role-playing games.
We've decided to do Lasers and Feelings as our current role with it unplugged, which we're pretty excited about. GM'd by Brian McKittrick. Thank you, Brian. And this time, a female voice, which is exciting. Sarah Wells joined me, and we did a little space adventure, tech zombies and whatnot. So, enjoy.
Wait, tech zombies?
Well, yeah.
Cyber zombies, yeah.
We're basically talking about the Borg here.
Oh, cool. I haven't had a chance to listen to it myself, but I'm interested to play the game. Unfortunately, I had to bow out of the game as well. I was interested in playing.
Yeah, we missed you.
Yeah, I couldn't play. I know Chris was in the same situation, kind of had to bow out, sounds like a fun game.
Yeah, well, I don't want to spoil anything narratively, so go listen to it. But
suffice to say, there are cyber zombies.
Yeah, there are cyber zombies, but that's the teaser. Mechanically, though, I'll be happy to talk about it, because, of course, as with all of our Roll With Its and Roll With It Unplugs, we don't focus much on the mechanics during the recordings, and that's by design, but... if you want to understand what is going on with that, it's actually a really simple system. You choose a number. And that number is the number that's going to divide you between lasers and feelings.
Now, it's not any number, right? It's a number between, like, is it like a...
Between one and six.
One and six, okay.
Well, really, we've mentioned this before on one of the previous episodes of the Brian Jones.
Yeah.
So you're using a D6.
One D6.
I didn't know if you're using a 6 or a 10 or 20.
No, it's one D6. And really, you should choose a number between 2 and 5, just because otherwise you're just saying that you're always going to succeed on that, you know, that one thing and always fail on the other, which doesn't make any sense.
That's a gutsy play.
You can play it as, like, talking the GM as, however you need to, into letting you roll lasers for everything, roll feelings for everything.
Arguably, yes, but this is Brian we're talking about. So, no, I really think it's a clever system. You know, Chris and I have always been looking for simple systems and designing simple systems, and especially ones that focus on narrative. And this one seems to do that. And so any time that it calls for something that might fail, you have to decide, is this something that's kind of technical, or is this something that has more to do with character? And so lasers versus feelings. And so if you're trying to fly the ship, then it would be lasers. But if you're in a storm and maybe your controls aren't working, then at that point it becomes feelings, because you have to kind of feel your way through the storm. But I like the system. I think it's really great. I think one of the neat things about it is that you have a scenario generator built into it, so that you can just roll a few things and just go. And it's kind of a out-of-your-pocket kind of a thing. You pull up the PDF, you play.
So you don't prepare beforehand?
You can right. You can, but there's really no need to.
So did Brian prepare beforehand?
He did not. No, okay. Not for the three-episode series that is now airing.
So he did the scenario generator, and it worked pretty well?
He did, and it worked great.
Okay, awesome. Yeah.
So that shows you how well that generator works.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
And there's always a pre-made, like, you don't have to follow it, but there's a pre-made sort of... here's the situation where the captain of your ship, the Raptor, Captain Darcy, is basically out of commission for the moment because of some being under the influence of some alien sentience you haven't encountered yet.
Yeah, the something else is what it's referred to.
And so that's why you've got the acting captain as one of the players and that sort of thing.
Right.
And is that kind of what y'all... sounds like the description.
Yeah, it's just a story hook that...
Just, yeah, right. You can kind of take it in whatever direction.
Exactly.
Right.
Cool.
And it could also be, most of the time I've heard it played, it's always been very silly. You know, people sort of parodying Star Trek.
But that may just be us, though. Really? I'm not sure.
Like, pretty much everyone I've heard of who plays it does it silly.
It's called Lasers and Feelings. How could possibly be that serious?
Mm-hmm. But that being said, I would be curious to see how it would play if someone did take it very seriously.
That's a good point.
So,
yeah.
It sounds like that would be terribly, dreadfully unfun. To be playing this sort of game and take it super seriously.
If you treated it as Star Trek and not a parody of Star Trek.
Phasers and empathy.
I suppose, but I gotta tell you, if I was involved in the game, that person would hate me because I'd immediately take it in a flight direction.
Oh, yeah.
I'm John Sider.
You know, I tend to have a trouble, like, maintaining seriousness.
Did you? I hadn't really noticed that at all.
Well, I like to have fun with it, so that's
well, we like to have fun with it, too.
Yeah, there you go.
It's kind of a running joke just with RPGs in general, where, like, you know, it's just kind of a cultural understanding that you start up with a party that's like, everyone's got these crazy backstories and, like, you know, super serious, and here's my role, and we're gonna do this, it's gonna be awesome, and then just immediately it evolves into just like goofiness. So,
yeah, that's true.
That's why I've given up even trying to be too serious with it, because I that's always happened to me. Like, I've always tried to be pretty serious, and then at a certain point you kind of give that up. You're like, no, I'm just gonna have fun with it.
And yeah,
I usually have a good time.
Of course, we ended up being pretty serious in our season 3 that's coming up.
Oh yeah.
Cool. The Lucky Strike that's coming up is going to be really interesting to see some reactions to that one.
Yeah, I'm interested in that one too. Yeah. I was not involved in that one as well.
Yeah, so. That's true.
Well, even the Lucky Strike sequel.
Which is going to be prequel, our unplugged. The prequel is the unplugged that's going to be following that.
And this is the one that's being sponsored by Lucky Strike cigarettes, right?
Unfortunately not.
Well, they don't exist anymore. Yeah, I know. So there you go.
It's an interesting sponsor, a company that no longer exists. Mm-hmm. But it did exist.
That's why we're getting paid nothing.
It did exist during the time period that this game
set. Well, it certainly did.
So there we go.
That's exactly right. Well, actually, there's a lot of hidden Easter eggs in that particular series.
Oh, cool.
About cigarettes.
Really?
And cigarette names. So there you go.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But, pick up a copy or download a copy of Lasers and Feelings.
It's free.
It's free on the website. So.
Oh, it is actually.
It's free on his website.
Yeah, it's just like a one-page system, pretty much.
What is this website address?
17design.com.
Okay, cool. Is that
spelled out, 17.
O-N-E-S-E-V-E-N.
Okay, so there's no like dash, like one dash, just 17.
I'd have to double check, but if you search 17design or you search John Harper as the name of the guy, you'll find it pretty easily.
Okay, cool.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
They're making an Angry Birds film. Yes, a 3D animated film.
It's almost, you didn't even have to say anything else, and then like drop the mic. Yeah.
Well, they already did that. It was from Rio.
Well, no, actually, Angry Birds had a licensed Rio game based on the film, but it wasn't an Angry Birds film. This is actually Angry Birds, the film.
That's deep.
The premise being, why are these birds so angry? Which is, of course, like, wasn't it kind of...
Because the pigs steal their eggs.
Yeah. I watched the teaser trailer for this thing, and clearly it's not meant for, like, mature audiences. It's for kids.
Really?
For people who...
Really?
Yeah, you know, who would guess?
Okay.
What would that be like,
at the same time,
if it was the R-rated Angry Birds?
What if it was the XXX-rated Angry Birds? I mean, if we're going there.
Let's not.
No?
NC-17, man. It's the 21st century.
Yeah.
But yeah,
I just mean extreme violence.
But what's funny though is that
Chris jumped to somewhere that he didn't have to. That you can have a XXX rated extreme violence game.
Yeah,
just put it
But even though like it's kind of meant for kids, like all the licensed Angry Birds stuff that's out there. At the same time, it's like it's not really kid friendly in a lot of ways. It's just like this irrationally angry character who like punts like cute little birds who, you know, like kick a soccer ball against his wall or something like that. Like, watch the trailer and it's not even like sort of a fun family film. It is just bad. Like, there was nothing redeeming about it. Like, the one thing that might have any appeal to me, at least, is that, like, when they say starring all these people you've never heard of, and Peter Dinklage. Peter Dinklage isn't even in the teaser, as far as I'm aware. It's just kind of like he probably makes a cameo that got him paid more than the headline.
Samuel L. didn't make the cut.
Hold on. I was assuming this was a computer-generated movie.
It is. But they have
so
voice
Peter,
actors.
So then it's just Peter Dinklage's voice.
Yeah. Maybe it's just not my kind of humor, but watching the teaser trailer, like, they were trying to put in a bunch of funny scenes, and they were just so generically quote-unquote funny that they weren't funny at
That's
all.
That's the way I feel about the entire Angry Birds franchise.
Yeah, but, yeah, I mean, like, if you're going to watch the teaser, maybe just watch it to see how bad it is, but this film is not going to be worth anyone's time, in my humble opinion.
And make sure that when you cut this, you cut it so that it sounds like you're giving a glowing review to the
Angry Birds is a
Angry Birds
garnered 5-star
review. 5-star review. So Two Wings Up.
Yeah, but are we the audience? I mean, really?
Clearly not.
No.
Angry Birds by definition is a casual game, right?
Our problem is that we're too hardcore into gaming, and I'm not even going to say it. I was going to get really mean, like, so I'm not even going to. I'm not going to.
The type of target audience that they're going for, like, those sort of, like, kid family 3D films,
yeah,
at least are funny and at least seem to be entertaining.
No, I agree with what Chris is saying. The one, like, the kid family stuff, it's like some of those can be pretty funny, and I'm one of those people that, I mean, I'll admit it. Sometimes I just watch like cartoons and like kid related stuff, and I can actually get into it. I like some cheesy stuff if it's done well.
Are you a Brony, Jim?
No, I'm actually not. I do not. I honestly have watched a few episodes, but I'm not a fan. Oh, I watched a few episodes because my best friend's wife was encouraging me to check some out. I just didn't like it.
Gotcha.
One of my friends who recently has had. Had kids, he actually has watched several of the episodes with one of his sons, and he was telling me, and like we were laughing about it, and asking if he was a Brony. He was like, yeah, I guess I am a Brony. So I guess he is.
Well,
do not edit that so that it sounds like I'm saying
This is the Gaming Meta, news and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
So we have the Gaming Meta segment where it's going to be a little extended, but we're going to talk about, unfortunately, the fall, or essentially the fall of one of gaming's most prolific companies, Konami. We've sort of been following this, the falling out between Konami and Kojima for a while, but it goes much beyond that, the way they've been treating their employees. The company has apparently decided, as of September the 18th was when the news broke on a whole bunch of different game sites, and it has been confirmed by one of the executives at Konami. They are now stepping away from the AAA game development circles, as in console development, PC development, to focus on mobile experiences, is what they are calling them, and also pachinko. Yes, erotic pachinko. This is now their focus for a company that has given us some of the greatest games and gaming franchises of all time, is now making erotic pachinko.
Well, not just erotic pachinko.
I salute them for going back to their roots.
the roots of erotic pachinko?
No. They started in the 1960s.
I love some of that, yes.
As
doing some pachinko. Yeah.
Well, as a company that made and repaired those kinds of games. This was before video games were ever there.
Yeah.
So I'm going to play devil's advocate on this one. I salute them for making a wise financial decision at a time whenever their company is under distress, because of over-arrogant and non-team-playing video game designers. Boom.
Yeah, but he's not a non-team-playing video game designer. They weren't giving his team any support. That's the problem.
Well, I think he was overextending his budget.
I think they're not giving enough budget to a legend in the field.
So just because you've made good games in the past means you should be able to write your own checks.
Exactly.
Then he needs to go to another company.
And I think he will.
I think he will too.
Happen. No, honestly, I think part of the issue is that I think Konami is, they don't have the stomach to continue in the way that the game industry is going right now.
In that case, I salute them for getting out.
They're getting out. Honestly, I kind of hope that everyone all the executives in Konami go completely bankrupt and wind up in a ditch somewhere with I'm very annoyed at this company leaving.
The views of Jim do not necessarily reflect
the other two backward compatible.
Yes, and that's fine, but I'm really salty about this because I was a huge Konami fan. But we're going to talk a little bit about this. I'd like to. This originally it broke a little bit before this news came out where they announced they were stepping away from AAA. Oh, and I should mention they are still going to be making the Pro Evolution Soccer series. That is the one series they're going to make. Are continue to make on consoles.
Very popular in Latin America.
It is actually very popular. No, and I've played a few of them. It's actually a pretty good series. Mm-hmm. It also uses the Fox engine that is used in Ground Zeroes and Phantom Pain. The Fox engine, by the way, this is what I was leading into. Julian Merceron, I hope I'm not mispronouncing his name. He was the worldwide technology director for Konami and also was the lead director of the Fox engine.
I was the host of Hollywood Squares.
No,
I'm not Tom Bergeron.
Yeah, he was of course a pretty big deal to company. He left essentially the same day or a day before. He quit the company again related to this news. So he's probably also going to get picked up by someone else.
Oh yeah,
I'm sure Kojima will as well. I mean, Kojima is still contracted to Konami until the end of this year because they still have some Metal Gear Online content that they've sort of. They promised, and so they're trying to get a little bit more of it out. Mm-hmm. And, of course, he's still under contract. I know he wants to get it out. He's very dedicated to trying to deliver what he promised. And I kind of see, in terms of going over budget, the thing with Kojima, is that he's always trying to fulfill what he's promised, and sometimes that does end up causing him to go over budget. But you have to respect a designer that is trying to give, his fans what they want. Obviously, the suits don't appreciate that, but I don't appreciate the suits, so there we go. Okay, so feelings mutual, I'm sure. But I don't want this to go too negative.
I'm sure they appreciate paying for the game.
Yes, exactly. And I support. I gave them $60. I paid full price, and I think it's worth the full price. But not going back into that, I do want to talk about some of the game series that they've made. And once I do that, we can talk about our first experience with a Konami game, and then what might be our favorite, sort of a memorial to a company.
I was
that
about
now
to say, it's starting to sound a lot really like well. a lot like a memorial service, a funeral sort of.
And that's I think that's kind of what it is, because even though the company
let's put the fun back in funeral,
then. Right? Exactly. Well, even though the company will be continuing, I'm not really a huge mobile gamer, quite frankly, and even the experiences they're going to be doing are not really going to be the same sort of experiences that even mobile gamers would necessarily We're talking about more. Mobile experience, app type stuff, and then plus, if you're a big, pachinko fan and you live in Asia, you might be. I'm sure we have plenty of listeners from that region of the world.
Well, not anymore. Good job, Jim.
What did I do to the anime?
All you noobs who like pachinko? No, you didn't say that. Exactly.
I didn't insult anyone that liked pachinko. Actually, I just insulted Konami for basically taking excellent video game series and turning them into a way to sell pachinko.
And the Konami execs who are loyal listeners of backward-compatible.com are no longer going to tune in. Good job.
And they can go to hell. I don't care.
Ouch.
I'm pretty negative on them.
The views of Jim do not necessarily reflect the views of backward-compatible.com.
That's fine. I'm anti these people. Anyway,
just make sure you download the podcast before you end up in the gutter, okay?
There we go. Okay, so here's I'm going to lead off some of the more prominent series from Konami. So in case, just to remember, in case y'all have forgotten what they've done. So obviously Metal Gear, Adventure Island, Contra, Castlevania, Dance Dance Revolution, Life Force / Salamander. It's one of my favorites. Frogger, Gradius, Silent Hill, Suikoden, Zone of Enders, Pro Evo Soccer, of course, Snatcher and Police Knots. Two early Kojima games, and also all of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles arcade games. So, Turtles in Time, the arcade game, Manhattan Project, all of those early ones. I believe they also did the Simpsons arcade game as well.
That makes sense.
So, guys, what was your first experience with Konami? I know all of us kind of came from an early gaming background, so I'm guessing these will probably be an arcade or a NES experience. But
it was probably Frogger on a home console for me, I had to guess. I'd played a bunch of the really, really early stuff. Mm-hmm. Not most of the stuff you listed I haven't played.
Like even DDR, I don't think I've actually played DDR proper. I've seen it, but I've like only played like generic spinoff or ripoffs.
You've never been tempted to embarrass yourself in front of a whole bunch of strangers?
I've totally embarrassed myself, okay. Just not with like DDR for reals DDR. So
I've totally embarrassed myself plenty of times.
But yeah, no, for the most part, you know, like obviously the big ones, Metal Gear, probably like most beloved Konami franchise if I had one.
You played Castlevania, at least a Castlevania at some point, I would imagine.
I've played a little bit of Castlevania, but actually not a ton. I've seen more Castlevania than I've played, so.
Have you ever played Silent Hill?
I have not. I've seen it.
It's kind of interesting. I've played some. Okay, but your first experience was Frogger?
Probably Frogger, yeah.
Doc?
I'm going to get serious. Up, up, down, down, left, right, BA, select, start. Mm-hmm. Now I'm ready to talk.
Contra. The Contra code, one of the remnants of Konami, one of the things that left us the industry as well, which we still see the Contra code in various Konami games since then. It was in the Gradius games, the Gradius series, also Life Force / Salamander.
Of course, that was without the select start element.
Yes, the select start was
that
for...
That got dropped later on for most.
Well, yeah, but originally the select start was in there for... you get like the two player as well. You get both lives from both characters.
That's right. Yeah. Well, you had to do select start because you were selecting which mode and hitting start to start the game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so if you didn't enter the code right before doing that, then it wouldn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And so in other games later, the select start wasn't there just because you didn't need to hit it in that way.
But yeah, so you were you a big Contra fan back then, or did you just kind of play it?
Well, you know, it's kind of interesting because whenever I got my NES or NES, if you prefer, I was living in a foreign country at the time, and so my friends at school, I was the only one who had a Nintendo. I was the guy, and so it was kind of cool. I had Nintendo Power coming about 3 months late because international mail, and there was a store down the road, and they rented video games. Mm. And also rented video cassettes, not entirely legally because it was a satellite dish and cable, quote unquote, was the guy down the street had a dish and he hooked us up. But you know, laws are different in other countries, so it wasn't illegal. It just was kind of opportunity. Regardless,
salutary neglect.
Yeah, there you go. We went down the street and we rented it, and I would rent Contra over and over and over again. And my best friend and I would sit down and we would play, and we played for hours and hours and hours and hours, and we beat it.
Awesome! It is a cool co-op experience.
Very much. Yeah,
it's really fun. The same thing with their shooters, which I've been a big fan of, like Gradius, the whole Gradius series, also Life Force, also known as Salamander in Japan and Europe, but. Those are probably some of my favorites, but in terms of the first one that I played, probably would be Life Force. It was a game that I owned on my NES. It was a game that I remember picking out from a store because it had a really cool snake, like this snake with an open mouth kind of wrapped around a planet logo. So it's like it looked so cool. I had to buy it, and I loved it. I played through it so many times. You know, was able to beat it by myself and kept going through it. I also played through it with, you know, my sister and some friends. And it's just, they had a pretty good handle on co-op experiences with, of course, their arcade games as well, where they had four-player beat-em-ups. They did some of those that also were later ported to the NES and the SNES, Super Nintendo. I believe that was probably my first, was probably Life Force. If not Life Force, it would have been Frogger, but it would have been Frogger at like a friend's place because I never owned an Atari.
Mm.
So I did have some friends did, but I don't remember playing like Frogger on Atari. I remember playing it on arcades, and that was a while after I had an NES too when I started going to arcades. So
I don't know if I've ever played, except maybe in like some weird flash port or something like that, the original Frogger. I think I always played like some, you know, Frogger remake or something like that.
Mm.
So
Chris, what would you say... is your all-time favorite Konami game? I know you said Metal Gear was your series that you love, but like just a single game that you would say is like the one. And maybe it's not necessarily the best. You don't have to say that. It's just that it's your personal favorite you enjoy the most.
Well, narrowing it down again to Metal Gear, it's hard to pick one.
Metal Gear.
That's really tough. Because I like a bunch of them for different reasons.
What was the one you had most fun playing? I guess is a better question. Even if you maybe liked another one better overall, mm-hmm. like what did you have the most fun?
I think 4 might be that. Although really? I will say for nostalgic purposes, I never played the original Metal Gear Solid, but I did play Twin Snakes. And probably mm-hmm. just for the nostalgia and for experiencing Metal Gear for the first time, I'd probably pick that one as my, we'll say, most memorable experience. Just because I'm not good at picking favorites.
That's fair. That's totally fair. That's a fun one. I think Twin Snakes sometimes gets a bad rap. Mm-hmm. I actually enjoyed Twin Snakes quite a bit.
Yeah.
It did get easier because they incorporated some of the mechanics
the first person mode, too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's sort of. But I think it gets a better rap. Plus, the graphics hold up a lot better than the original
for sure.
PlayStation. So, Doc, what? I mean, is Contra also your favorite? It was your first.
I have
first
fond love, memories of it. Fond memories, but no, actually, I would go with the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the original.
The arcade game?
Yeah. Well,
or the original that was on the NES.
The original that was on the was it Nintendo? Was it the Super or was it the NES?
NES. If it was just called Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles,
yeah.
it was definitely the NES. There also was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles the arcade game on the NES and also on the arcade.
Okay. No, I wasn't exposed to that many arcade games. You got to remember being in another country.
Well, these were ported. Same thing with like Turtles in Time, for example, was ported to the Super Nintendo.
Right, but there were changes a lot of times, like the music and stuff would change. But
sometimes they do new ones. So you mean the original?
I mean the original one, the one where you had to swim around in the sewers and all of that. It was those levels were awful. But yeah, I slogged through that game until I beat it, and that was a huge accomplishment. Hmm. So in that sense, I felt a great sense of accomplishment in that game. It's not the first game I beat, but it's the first game I beat that I felt like I had done something monumental.
That's a great feeling. I loved that back when when games were really hard but winnable with enough practice and skill, and it really felt like when you won, you accomplished something.
Yep. Absolutely hate that design now, but I remember it fondly.
We have less free time now, so maybe that's a big part of it.
That's actually going to play a little bit into some comments I have on Mario Maker when we get to that.
Okay, so cool.
More on that later.
But yeah, so that's a good choice. I mean, I own that game too. I mean, I own that game. I played it all the time. I never beat it legit because I honestly couldn't handle.
Yeah, that was about the era whenever we came out with. Was it Game Shark? Is that what it was called?
Yeah, Game Genie, Game Shark.
Game Genie.
Yeah, that's how I got through. And to be honest with you, I wasn't quite in love with it enough to dedicate that much time. Like for example, Life Force, which is actually a pretty hard game.
Yeah, it is.
You know, I beat that game many, many times, including without the Contra code, after, you know, beating it with the Contra code, obviously. Mm-hmm. But that was because I love the game so much. I tried to learn all the tricks and all the nooks and crannies to it. And, you know, for me, with the Turtles, yeah, there were definitely some tricks that I learned and I went through. But at a certain point, I mean, I just didn't enjoy myself as much with it. I was able to get to the Technodrome, but I just didn't enjoy it enough to really push, but I can see why there's definitely an appeal there, because it's a challenging game and pretty fun to get through.
Mm-hmm.
I guess for me, my favorite, I mean, this is kind of a tough choice. I've liked a lot of their series. Like, for example, I loved Life Force. I mean, Gradius 5 might be my favorite shooter from them, although technically that was by Treasure technically developed that one. Konami just published it, so I don't know if that really counts in terms of shooters. But no, my favorite game from them was probably a tough call. I really love Castlevania, but I'm probably going to have to go with the Metal Gear game as well. Probably the third Metal Gear.
Mm, Metal Gear Solid 3?
Yeah, Metal Gear Solid 3. Just because, for me, I loved the addition of the camo aspect to it, which has been carried over into later games.
Mm.
I also really, really loved, I feel it is the strongest story, in the series.
I can agree with that, yeah.
And that is sort of a big reason why I think it had a good marriage of story and gameplay. I'm having so much fun with Metal Gear Solid 5 that it's possible it could knock it off its perch.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I've heard the story kind of goes down, but of course, gameplay-wise, Metal Gear Solid 5, hands down.
As far as gameplay, Metal Gear Solid 5 is absolutely the best Metal Gear ever.
And I don't know if you'd really get too many people arguing that one, but you know, that, but of course there's more to a game than just that.
Sure.
So.
Yeah.
But yeah, that might be my choice. Metal Gear Solid 3 is a pretty good choice for me. Possibly I'm looking at something like maybe something like Symphony of the Night is another, you know, Castlevania Symphony of the Night is another one that would be up there for me. Some of the other Metal Gear Solid games like the original or, two,
mm-hmm.
you know, great, like I said, Gradius, Gradius 5, Life Force. So some of these games, you know, I love Snatcher when I played it. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a pretty fun game. I know I've talked about it on the podcast as well.
But clearly the best best Konami game ever, Dance Dance Revolution.
Yeah, hey, that was a huge game. That made them a lot of money.
Sure.
So, I mean, Dance Dance Revolution, some people really got into it. It was very competitive.
I mean, because if they're going more for, like, casino, arcade-style stuff, I could actually see them continuing DDR.
Actually haven't done DDR in a long time. They've dropped that series for quite a while. Mm. Unless that something changes, I'm not so sure that scene is as profitable as it used to be.
That's probably true, yeah.
So, I'm not so sure. But, I mean, who knows? Mm. Maybe so.
Started a genre.
Mm-hmm.
It was very influential, definitely.
Maybe they'll come out with DDR VR, where you put on a VR headset and then also have to dance.
Oh, God. Oh, DDR VR. My. DDR VR, that sells itself. Then you're going to have, like, it sort of like with the Wii, where people were throwing their remote at the screen. It's going to be like you're going to be kicking your kid and your cat and your, like, TV screen. And because, like, you got the VR, you can't see anything. You're just, like,
See it working, like, at an arcade where, like, you're kind of caged in a sense. And it's kind of like there's a stay back area.
So not a home version?
Probably not a home version.
Because the home version for sure wouldn't work, for example, in the Japanese market, because they don't have that space in their homes to do that.
Sure.
I know there were complaints about that with the Kinect when it first came out, because Microsoft had designed it to have a certain amount of space between your TV and where you would stand, so the sensors would work right.
Mm-hmm.
And Japanese homes, the typical Japanese home, didn't have that space.
Sure.
Interestingly.
Mm-hmm.
But,
Microsoft's based in America, so they probably weren't thinking that.
Yeah. So this is sort of our fond farewell to Konami, and I wish a lot of these developers, a lot of these teams, by the way, they've all been dissolved.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a ton of developers now that are going back into the market, people with a wide variety of skills, like in programming, in art, in software engineering, design. And so where these people end up, I mean, is anybody's guess. There was already kind of an exodus going on before this happened. I think it was probably a lot of these designers, like Iga, Igarashi of Castlevania, or Hideo Kojima for Metal Gear, but a bunch of them, I'm sure they sort of like were made aware of themselves being kind of marginalized in the company anyway. They kind of saw it coming, but a lot of the other ones have now left too, because of course these divisions have been dissolved. So
what about Konami America though?
What's happening
with that?
I know that there's a LA studio. They're the ones doing Metal Gear Online right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They're still going to be kept around for a little while, as long as, because Metal Gear Online, they're still maintaining it and trying to finish up, you know, a few of the promised updates until the end of the year. It's not like they're shutting down production immediately. It's just they're not taking on new projects. So things like Metal Gear Online are being maintained for a while, but they're just not going to take on any new AAA projects, except for Pro Evo. So some of these might still be doing Pro Evo related stuff, but they're not going to be taking on new projects.
Nah, I don't think it'll last.
You don't think so?
No, I think just like Twinkies, when everybody was like, oh, it's the last Twinkie ever, oh no, let's spend $300 on a Twinkie. Man, I was in the store the other day, and there was a whole shelf full of Twinkies.
So we're doing a little reckless speculation now, it sounds
yeah, it sounds like it.
Your salt shakers, because it's time for some reckless speculation. Our excuse to engage with rumors, hearsay, and all sorts of crazy theories.
And so you're saying that just not going to last. Konami's going to start back up again, because they've let go of a lot of developers. I've heard in Japan, a lot of people were being let go.
Yeah.
So you think they're just going to like go ahead and maybe in a few years, because they have the properties, or do you think they're going to actually?
What?
That's how I felt when I heard this news. Mainly because I'm loving Metal Gear Solid V so much, and I've heard that the ending comes across as rushed, and they're sort of missing a chapter, mainly because they, you know, deadline wise, they've been preparing to make this move for a while, and it was coming to this deadline. That's why they wanted to release the game, get it out, even though it wasn't quite finished. Makes me feel sad, because it means we're not going to be able to get that as a new release, as some sort of like expansion or DLC content or anything.
Director's cut version,
because they're not doing that anymore. And it kind of makes me sad. So that's the way I felt. I'm pretty sad about it. So that's why I'm kind of salty. It's more like comes from a place of love. This is a company I was really into. Mm. Of course, a lot of the people that I respected from the company are gone now.
The sounds of Ian's crying.
Someone's unhappy.
The sounds of me crying. I think it's because he's a baby.
He rarely does
that. That's my, you know, I'm putting my my psychology degree to good use.
Wow.
He's a baby.
You're a genius, Jim.
How did I do it?
But, yeah, I mean, I very seriously think that the company will start making games again and that he will go off making games somewhere else. And it's just, it's a normal part of the ecology of the gaming industry.
I know Iga has already been doing his own thing recently. So, you know, Igarashi from the Castlevania series has been putting out his own new designs, new work.
Hot buddy.
Now joining us at the table is the crybaby himself.
I've been here the whole time. Oh, you mean the actual baby. Yeah. But yeah, I would love to see Kojima get possibly picked up by... Because I'd honestly... Someone like Iga, I can see him doing, and he is doing, like, being successful on Kickstarter and doing some, you know, 2D Castlevania work because that doesn't take as much of a budget, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But Kojima, he dreams big. He likes to have these huge games. That's what Metal Gear Solid 5 is, and that's one of the things people expect from Kojima. So they do kind of have come to expect the cinematic experience. So I do believe that Kojima, for him to be successful, he needs to join up with another big publisher. And I think he will. I think somebody like... Even like a Sony or a Microsoft might actually.
Sony would love yeah, would to love have Kojima to exclusives. Yeah,
yeah.
That would sell so many PlayStations. So.
And so I think that might be the case. I think Sony he might end up approaching him and saying, "Look, do you want to come on and have your own team?"
Well,
then hopefully that won't be his reaction. Hopefully he'll be.
Don't you think though that if he is picked up by somebody, let's say it's Microsoft,
yeah,
that he'll be challenged to do a new property and it'll be great,
will.
And you know, you guys will have nerdgasms about it, and won't it all be a good thing?
It very well could. You very well could be. You're right. I mean, Metal Gear. Part of it, honestly, I think Metal Gear series was winding down anyway. It's just I'm sad because
it wound down about 3 games ago.
Well, you're not a fan, so I understand. You don't quite have that connection. But I do think that 5. The part that makes me sad is that 5 was almost complete. You know, just apparently there's some cut stuff where there was supposed to be a whole third chapter. There's really just 2 that were released. And people have found it on the disc, and they know it's there, and there's just a little bit more story they could have told. So it feels kind of sad that they almost got the whole thing out.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really it. It's not like I think that there should be like a Metal Gear 7, 8, 9, that kind of thing, but I get that it's winding down, but I'm a little sad that they didn't quite finish all of it. But you're right, he's going to do some new series, and he's done some other things in his career, like Snatcher, that are very different from Metal Gear.
Mm-hmm. You know, like, I think he and Guillermo del Toro are still wanting to do a collaboration at some point.
Yeah.
Even if it's not Silent Hill. So.
Yes.
Well, and you referenced Japanese culture a minute ago, so I'm wondering, within the context of that, I am no expert, who's in the wrong here? Because to have wasted your company's money like that and to have acted out like that...
He didn't... hold on. That's something that Konami has been putting out. If you actually read a lot of these reports, the Konami has been severely mistreating their employees for a long period of time. And Kojima is just one of those that he's high enough profile that he's been able to fight back. And that's just some of the ways he's been fighting back.
Handing off the baby.
Mm-hmm. They've been treating they've been taking a whole bunch of draconian measures towards their employees. Things like you know, spying on them, moving them into, you know, much smaller spaces, crowding them out, cutting a lot of their benefits, doing a whole bunch of stuff that is you know, pretty nasty. Their work conditions were some of the worst in,
but nasty,
even in the country.
Nasty based on what? Based on a Western ideal?
No, nasty even for Japanese companies, and with the goal of trying to get them to quit.
And
which is like pretty cold hearted. Really,
at that point, you might as well just fire them. But then, of course, it comes across better if it's like, oh, there were mass resignments instead of.
No, I think it was because if they fired them, they would have to, like, there was, like, you know, severance deals and contracts and stuff like that.
And you
like
said he's high enough profile to fight back, but that's a Western concept, too.
What is?
Being a high enough profile figure to be able to publicly denounce the company that you say is mistreating you.
I think that's an American concept that I personally love, is the idea of the little guy fighting back against the big power.
Oh, yeah.
And that's something that I think if you... The Metal Gear games themselves are big on in terms of thematically. It's a big theme in the series is the little guy getting screwed and going up against a bigger force. I personally, you know, I love, and Kojima's not the only one doing it, by the way. You know, like I said, Igarashi's another example of a Konami employee. Mm-hmm. Did the exact same thing. And this is because, a big part of this is because their team members are also being mistreated, and that's one of the things that they speak out about. And the same thing, I mean, the same sort of concept, where these people are, unfortunately, and yes, there is, Japanese game, like, game companies are notorious for working, for having their employees work long hours. That mm-hmm. is true, and so they do have a different standard over there. But Konami went above and beyond. It wasn't just the typical Japanese culture. This is stuff that is to the point that it's exploitative, and they're also taking advantage of the Japanese cultural attitude of being willing to put up with some of this stuff, because there's, you know, less, there's this sort of like trust and family orientation with companies that they have in Japan that we don't have in the West, where mm-hmm. they stay with companies for most of their lives. They're treated as being like, you know, a part of the, you know, family related part of this company, that kind of thing. And so when you abuse that trust, which is something that Konami has kind of done, it's even more deplorable, in my opinion, than someone in like the West doing it, when there's this, not even that expectation of being treated that way. So I do think that it's something that I do think is a problem, unfortunately. But like I said, I mean, I think these people will be fine. I think that a lot of them, a lot of these people are very talented, and I think they will be fine, and they will find work elsewhere. So I'm not talking about just the big names like Kojima, like Iga, like Julian Merceron, all these guys. I'm talking about the entire, like all of the, you know, the software engineers and the designers and the programmers and, you know, all the 3D modelers and the animators and all that. They're going to find work. I'm not saying that they're not going to. And I'd love to see a lot of the Fox Engine or the Fox team reunited under a banner like Sony is a company that is big enough to bring them in and sort of make them like the centerpiece of PlayStation, given that, quite frankly, PlayStation 4 is really lacking for exclusives right now. I mean, what do they have? In my opinion, nothing. You know, the games I'm playing the most of are not exclusives. They're in all multiple systems. Like, Metal Gear Solid 5 is even on the PS3 and the Xbox 360 on last-gen systems. Mm-hmm. So if they were to bring in and start having actually high-profile exclusives, that would help them in the market.
Because there was a period when Metal Gear was pretty much a PlayStation series. It wasn't like, it wasn't first or second party, but they were only being published on PlayStation.
Correct. So it is something that I do think is certainly worth them exploring. I could totally see them pick them up. By the way, I could totally see Microsoft going, especially given the money they have and the weight they have to push around. And I'm sure Kojima would be fine with that if he gets a good deal. Essentially,
I'm sure Microsoft wouldn't mind having a stronger foothold in Japan.
In the Japanese market.
Because Sony definitely dominates Microsoft in Japan.
Right now,
the console sales are extremely lopsided.
But yes, yeah, so it's mainly just the Microsoft, the Xbox sales are just not really that big.
Yeah,
but yeah, you're right, and so I do think that's something that they will consider, or it might be. I don't, you know, Kojima, I don't think is old enough to the point where I'm worried about him retiring, but he might take a step back. I don't know. Like I said, we have until December to find out. He still is under contract with Konami, so I'm sure that even if he's already had job offers, he's probably not supposed to, publicly mention them yet, as long as he's still under contract. So he's finishing up Metal Gear Online. I'm still going to hold out hope that maybe he's finishing up DLC, expansion, something.
My highly unlikely dream scenario is that Kojima teams up with Nintendo.
That would be pretty interesting, I will say. And that would be the sort of things that he might be able to do, because he is quite creative. He's done some creative stuff. I understand he's also a divisive figure. So the way that he presents his game, some people don't necessarily like. And I find it, to me, pretty interesting that I'm such a big Kojima fan, because I'm definitely someone that actually will speak out against too many cinematics in games and too many, like, you know, too many cutscenes and not getting straight to the gameplay. And yet I love Kojima's work. And so part of it, I think, is his presentation and the way that he sort of blends that kind of serious storytelling and cinematics with a very, you know, tongue-in-cheek, you know, meta understanding of it being a game, and that sort of presentation really appeals to me. And I think maybe it's just something that we're kind of on the same wavelength, and that might be why that it just appeals to me, and sort of similar thinking process. I don't know, but yeah, it's something that, and I totally get though why you may not be as big of a, same thing with the, like, the mechanics and the tactical approach and all that. That doesn't appeal to some people either. So, that being said, I don't think that it can be denied that he's had an impact on the industry, a pretty big one.
Actually, that's the one thing about the series that I've enjoyed.
Is what, the impact?
Tactical espionage.
the mechanics. The core mechanics.
Oh, okay.
But the whole scenario just kind of reeks of two gorillas beating their chest to see who gets to be the alpha male. You've got the execs on one end, and you've got an overpowered and overpumped artist on another. And to me, I really don't care about either of them.
It's fair. I honestly think that it's sort of dishonest to compare one designer who doesn't really have that much pull to a company that's like, you know, multi-billion dollar company. It's kind of an unfair comparison. It's more like,
just said he was the only one with enough pull to be able to shout out about what's really going on. Which is it?
No. Well, he's actually not. I actually mentioned Iga as well, and some of the other ones have come out anonymously. He's one of the few, along with Iga, that can come out with his name, because he didn't care because he was already going to leave the company anyway. But just because he can do that doesn't mean that he has anywhere near as much power as a multinational corporation.
Because ultimately the game did get rushed out.
Yeah.
You know, if he had his way, it wouldn't have.
Exactly. If he had his way, they would have had a few more months of development and he could have actually finished it. So I think it's more like, I see what you're saying, but I don't think you can compare, because, I mean, money rules. You're talking about a company that still has several hundred million, if not billions, probably billions, of dollars, you know, in there, or at least money that they can use. I'm not saying it's all profit, but they have that much money. Where you and then you have like a designer who maybe is a millionaire, probably not. I mean, honestly, probably not.
If he's not, he's not doing it right.
Well, I mean, how many game designers really? I mean, even like the super high up there guys. I mean, if they've made a million, they're like at the low end of the millionaire scale.
Well, you don't make a million off the sales. You make a million by investing well.
Right. And so, yeah. So maybe he has. But the point is that we're talking about a huge, huge difference in terms of power.
And I wasn't talking about power.
Well, you were. You said it's like two gorillas beating their chest, which is not true. It's more like a gorilla and, like, you know, a bonobo or something. I mean, it's... Maybe he sees himself as
it's
a gorilla.
It's like the Tyrannosaurus Rex and the genetically created... What was that thing called?
The weird, yeah. But see, the problem with the T-Rex is I don't think he could beat his chest. You have to just kind of like flap his arms like this, trying to.
it's the little chihuahua barking at the Doberman.
Yes, there
you go.
Yes,
yeah.
But okay. So
all I was saying was we don't know who started it.
Yeah, and there always are like two sides to everything, and I'm sure that like no one's totally faultless in this thing, and neither is either one totally to blame. You know, it's just kind of like I think as artists ourselves, we naturally want to side with the artist.
No, I understand. I'm sure there's an element of him wanting to do more than the budget allowed, and I get that.
Mm-hmm.
That still doesn't excuse mistreatment of employees mm-hmm. that they have done. I'm not talking just about Kojima. I'm talking about the entire
company. Yeah.
It doesn't excuse their practices and the way that they've been treating their employees, because nothing does.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, nothing excuses that. But yes, I understand. In terms of literally just their relationship with Kojima... yes, I will say they are somewhat justified in wanting to hold the game to a certain schedule. That being said, mm-hmm. as someone who works in a you know, software company,
mm-hmm.
I can tell you right now that sales tends to drive, and marketing tends to drive schedules, and they tend to not know
mm-hmm.
a damn thing about what it takes to actually make something.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll set a date that has no bearing in reality and then expect you to hold you to it. And that is absurd.
Mm-hmm.
So I do think we do have to at least admit that perhaps they didn't set a realistic date in the first place. But regardless, you know, we don't want to spend all day on it, but I do think it is a good discussion, and thank you, Doc, for having a drawing out a good back and forth discussion.
What was their comparison? Like a project manager, someone who, or a programmer says we can have one programmer do this in 80 hours, and a project manager says let's have 80 programmers do it in 1 hour.
Yeah.
which is like, that's not how it works.
Which also is impossible, doesn't
yeah.
work.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
I have been playing Star Wars Uprising. There's a couple of interesting things about it. First of all, it's worth pointing out it's canon. Now that we have so much that is legacy, meaning extended universe has been put over into maybe it happened, maybe it didn't. Mm-hmm. Anything that's coming out right now that is considered canon and being acknowledged canon is worth mentioning. Like the book that came out, and of course everyone is screaming over the Star Wars game that's about to come out.
Yes,
Battlefront.
Battlefront, yes. Right?
Which
it's not really supposed to be canon though, as far as I'm aware.
Well, yeah, it
I
is
thought
canon.
It was. Yeah,
it
I
is.
Thought it was.
Absolutely, it's canon.
Well, it's not like it's going to be adding anything new to
it. Oh, are you kidding? It resurrected Boba Fett. Have you not heard about this? Yes, it's fantastic. It resurrected Boba Fett. But that's not what I'm here to talk about. What I'm actually wanting to talk about is Star Wars Uprising. It is, if you will indulge me, a bit like a mobile version of an MMO.
I got that impression
too. In short.
Yeah.
So if you're a fan of the Old Republic, you know, Star Wars Tor, if you will, SWOTOR, as it was lovingly called, and you especially like the way that they did the instances, remember you walk through a door and you're having your own little private thing going on, check out Uprising. You might like it. The plot is basically, and this is not really spoilers to talk about this, it takes place right after the Return of the Jedi. There's an Imperial governor. His name is Adelhard. I wouldn't recommend trying your Adelhard. if you do, you know, warm up first. And he's... I don't even know what that means. I have no idea. But you're in the Anuat sector, right? And so this is the governor. He doesn't want to release his grip. He doesn't care that Vader's dead. He doesn't care that the Emperor's dead. Which is a thing now. They're actually dead. If you were a fan of the comics, they didn't die for a long time. Well, the Emperor, anyway. He had clones and stuff. But
Did you just say Vader is actually dead?
Vader is actually dead.
Okay. Well, after this, we'll talk about how he's apparently not, but go ahead.
Okay, well, fair enough. he's a being of light, so there we go.
Maybe.
He's not dead, right?
Maybe.
He's Hayden Christensen.
Oh, don't even.
You're right, actually.
But the point is... You get to play as either like a smuggler or a bounty hunter or a rebel guerrilla or a diplomat or a gambler. And the way that things are done, it unlocks slowly over time where you can't sell stuff till you're level 10 and you can gain crew and have crew missions. And it really feels MMO style so that it teaches you as you go. It's well designed. It's got classic cinematic wipes, you know how the screen wipes from right to left. It feels really Star Wars when it does that. The graphics are just polished enough so that you really get the feeling that it's in that world. And I'm having a lot of fun with it. It's very samey. I'm not going to pretend that it's not. But if you're into doing those kind of runs and the idea of a three-quarter view little shooter and you go through, you know, if you're a fan of those types of games. What are some of the old RPGs from 20 years ago that had that three-quarter view? The classics.
Diablo, Baldur's Gate.
Yeah, those kind of things. Honestly, it feels a little bit like a Star Wars version of that in real time. But the way they did a swipe and hold for, it's about 5 different controls. I think it's really good, and you can switch out the sets that you want. Do I want a stun ability, or do I want something that's a power-up ability? Do I want a buff? Do I want a shotgun, or do I want that sort of thing? What you will not find is force abilities, and what you will not find is lightsabers. And I call that a win, actually. I know that our friend Will Parsons would agree with that one. But anyway, yeah, check it out. If nothing else, download it, play it to level 10, and if you're enjoying it, you're welcome.
So do we want to touch on Star Wars before we get going, or is it too off
the path? How would it be touching?
Well, you mentioned Darth Vader being dead.
And do some other stuff.
Apparently he's not. Yeah, here's some other stuff that you just reminded me of.
Back to the other stuff.
Back to the other stuff. Vader and I, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff. Apparently the current story is that Hayden Christensen is confirmed that he's involved in the new Star Wars movie. And apparently... I'm sorry, when I say the new Star Wars, I think it's actually not 7, I think it's 8, specifically.
Well, yeah, he'll be being a pure light who shows up to his grandchild or something.
That's actually not confirmed. In fact, the current rumors are that it's possible that Darth Vader is alive again, or a clone of Vader could be alive again, they're not sure. But it's possible that it's an actually living person and not a...
Well, maybe he's playing his own grandson.
Also possible?
With the brilliant acting skills of Hayden Christensen.
Yeah. I'm not entirely sure what this means, and to be perfectly honest, no one is sure what it means because it's such an early rumor. All we know is that he seems to be involved in episode 8, and the current rumors are that it is going to be Darth Vader and not... Because if he's a being of light, he's not really Darth Vader.
My instinct, though, is Anakin. If it's Hayden Christensen as Vader, though, like, if it's actually Vader, it would just be like either a suit or CG with potentially James Earl Jones's voice.
No, he was Vader in the third one before he got the full, you know, body replacement.
Oh, sure.
Thing. But he was still Vader. So that's what they're talking about, is him as
like a flashback sort of thing, or
I mean
that sounds the most likely.
But if it's a whole clone thing, it would be literally he would have a body again. So it's the same point. Reveal. So we don't know. And Star Wars has a history of like clone like that thing. I mean, the expanded universe, yes, but still that is a part of the lore.
It is canon.
So that would be an intriguing thing to see, actually, how Darth Vader would operate if he wasn't in a suit.
Precisely. So maybe it would be interesting. I don't know. But hey, I'll say this. If it's Hayden Christensen directed by someone that can actually direct, maybe it could be good.
Yeah,
we don't know.
True. Well,
so,
I mean, Natalie Portman's a brilliant actress, and
exactly.
She did terrible acting.
Exactly.
As directed by
Liam Neeson is an excellent actor.
Absolutely, he is.
Ewan McGregor,
yeah.
Great actor. Mm. Of course, they sounded like wooden, you know, dummies,
yeah,
with George Lucas directing. So of course we know that they. It's not necessarily
this
terrible.
This is why we don't film. Record the podcast against a green screen.
There you go.
It wouldn't be entertaining.
I agree.
Yeah.
We recorded at separate times. That's the thing. We have to actually play off each other.
Yeah, And also, you know, we could insert anything. Watch out for that T-Rex behind.
Yeah. It's beating his chest. let's...
Barely scratching.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to move on, finally, to our meaty topic. 30th anniversary of Super Mario Brothers. yes, and Doc, it looks like, have you looked up some information about, in terms of specifically the date? And it was 1985, but specifically when Super Mario Brothers originally came out on the Famicom. An interesting thing about that, too, is that in America, in the West, and in Europe as well, we look at Super Mario Brothers as being the first or one of the first games on the system, but that's actually not true. It was a game that came out 2 years after the Famicom released in Japan. The Famicom released with games like... Popeye, Donkey Kong, these are arcade ports, and like baseball, things like that were originally coming out. And for a few years, the system had kind of a rough run trying to figure out what it could do and developers learning what they could do with it. Super Mario Brothers, when it came out in 1985, it was the template for platformers, but also home console games in general. It was the template for the way that you present a game. Without having the arcade style of, we're going to make it really hard, it's going to be this short experience, and you're going to die a lot, but you're going to feed us more quarters. That sort of design philosophy still kind of carried over for some of those early Famicom games, and Super Mario
That's
Brothers
true,
was the first one that really kind of broke that mold and became this, we want everyone to play through and have this experience. And it was, I'm not going to say it's an easy game, it's kind of hard,
yeah.
But at the same time, it had a totally different presentation from what people were used to in the arcades. It was a groundbreaking title.
True.
And of course, some of the conceits of the arcade, like having limited lives and having to continue or start
and
over
scores.
If you run out.
It had a score, which later Mario games sort of did away with.
Mm-hmm.
But things like that were still, of course, persistent. But it was very influential in the way that not just platformers, but the home market developed for video games.
Yeah. Okay, so I want to do a Mario Price is Right. I want you to give me the right answer without going over. All right? It's a mini icebreaker in the meaty topic. It's meat on ice.
I love
which
it.
Is always a good idea. Okay,
frozen meat.
Yeah, exactly. How many Mario games has Mario appeared in since his creation?
Oh, are we just doing any Mario game and not just Super Mario?
I want a number.
And also not non-Mario games.
Okay, well, let's go with that then. How many games has Mario appeared in since his creation?
Video games?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just to make sure we're doing that.
I'm going to say 250.
Okay. Closest without going over is what we're looking for.
$1.
So you think it's less than 250?
Yeah, I do. Oh, yeah. Should I be fair and actually make a guess?
No, you don't have to.
Yeah, I'll say something like, you know, 150.
The actual answer is 212.
Oh!
I went over.
Wow.
So Jim wins that one.
Wow, okay.
Okay. The next question is, how much... So keep score. Keep your score.
Oh, sure.
How much, or how many units of the Mario series of games, in this case it is the Mario series of games, have been sold? How many units?
Wait, you mean Super Mario series?
I mean the Mario series.
So does that include Mario Kart, Super Mario Bros?
Right.
I mean Super Mario.
Anything
Smash
with Mario
Brothers.
In the title, essentially.
Oh.
How many units?
I'll say 100 million.
I was going to say something like that, too. How about... I'm going to say 120 million.
Okay. The answer is 210 million.
Oh.
Oh, nice.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. Wow, huh?
That is a lot.
So...
Wow.
That one goes to...
Jim.
What... This should be an easy one. What year did Mario first appear?
I believe it was 81.
I'll say 79.
Okay. And for a bonus point, what game?
Donkey Kong.
Donkey Kong.
Okay. And that was July 9th, 1981 in the arcade.
Okay. That's what I thought. Yeah.
Well done. Well done. So I don't think we need to further embarrass Chris by reiterating the score. However, that was tough. That was very tough, actually. Yeah. So, all right, Jim. Well, you have definitely won your Mario, shall we say, leaf, crown, fireball.
Superstar.
Yeah, superstar.
Mushroom.
The what was the name of that shoe? The big shoe? Karibo shoe or something? I want the shoe. I want to win I want to win that big green shoe that they didn't use enough. They used it that one level in Super Mario Bros. 3, and I thought that was so cool. You could just jump on... You could actually jump on those damn spinies. Spiny things that Lakitu drops. Like Gremlin guy in the clouds. You could finally jump on those things and kill them. It was so fun. And
I think they might have that boot in Mario Maker.
Yeah, they probably do. I'm sure they do.
I'm a hammer Mario man myself.
Those are cool. Where you can duck in and now you have the protective shell. Mm-hmm. I love some of the ones they had. Even in Galaxy, they had some really cool stuff that they added into it. Like the spring.
The spring was kind of fun, yeah.
Spring was fun. I liked the bee. I honestly did like the bee. But Fire Mario is classic. Mm-hmm. Is that we want to talk about Mario. I guess we're talking about Mario Power-Up, some of our favorite. That shoe. I think I love that shoe.
Partially for nostalgia and partially because it was awesome. My favorite all-time Mario Power-Up was the cape. The cape feather.
Really?
Yeah.
See, that's an interesting thing, too. Because, I honestly didn't like Mario World as much. It just felt...
That was my first real Mario game.
Yeah, it felt like it was just... It felt a little bit more aimless than some of the other. I didn't really feel like it was as focused design. I didn't like it. I didn't like the levels as much. I really preferred Mario 3 in terms of some of the old 2D ones. Same thing with the 3D. I didn't really like 64 as much. I didn't really like the. It became more of an adventure. That one was in particular more of an adventure game than a platformer. That's why I liked Mario Galaxy so much, because it was a platformer with all these cool ideas, with flipping upside down and going on, messing with gravity and all that. And,
2 was my favorite.
I love 2. Yeah, 2
and,
is one of
and my that one was
too.
My favorite for one very simple reason. I liked the world. I liked the dream design. I liked the flipping it around, all that stuff. Honestly, it came down to the fact that you could choose your character and there were special abilities. I mean, different abilities, mostly to do with jumping, but hey, it's Mario.
I wonder if you would like Super Paper Mario. It is not Paper Mario the RPG, it's based on that series, but it is a platformer RPG hybrid where you actually, you jump on things and it deals a certain amount of damage, RPG style, but you can also have different characters with different abilities.
Really?
It's actually got some really neat elements.
Yeah, it's very different. Mm-hmm. It's very different. I will say this about Mario 2, just to get back to Super Mario 2, and I know you mean the U.S. version of Super Mario 2.
I do, yeah.
Right. Originally, that was Doki Doki Panic in Japan, which was on the Famicom, which had a whole different cast of characters.
Did it.
And they were like this, they were this, it was a family of, an Arabic family.
Mm-hmm.
And it was mama, papa, and then two kids. And you have to rescue a couple of the kids. They have a chimp. I forget exactly. It's the interesting thing though, different in terms of the story was, or the way the gameplay played rather, is in order to actually beat the game, you had to beat each level with each character.
Oh, wow.
So you could do it. You could go through the entire game if you wanted to with one character and then go back and do it all, or you could do each level individually.
Sounds like the Lego franchise.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting, but it was a lot harder in that way. But some people have speculated that, of course, later a lot of those characters were actually incorporated into the Mario mythos, except for poor Big Boss Wart. We never see him again. But kind of interesting. It's some people have said that Nintendo intentionally, because essentially the Doki Doki Panic characters were licensed from some like cartoon company or something in Japan. I forget exactly where it came from. They're not Nintendo-owned characters, which is why you never hear them reference those characters. Uh-huh. They don't want to. They only talk about the Mario version of that game, Mario 2. It was designed by Miyamoto, by the way.
We hadn't mentioned him up to this point.
Shigeru Miyamoto, the creator of Super Mario Brothers, who did also design Super Mario Bros. 2/Doki Doki Panic, both of them. He did design Doki Doki Panic. So, anyway, I think people have said that Miyamoto may have done was they wanted to experiment with something different with Mario. Mm-hmm. So they intentionally used these different characters. It had always been intended to be a Mario game, is what people have been saying. Ah. It's kind of like the rumor, kind of an unconfirmed rumor, but if you look at a lot of the presentation and what was going on at Nintendo at the time, it actually was a pretty smart move to sort of put it out there as like this different idea, this different game, and kind of test the waters in terms of what you can do with the system, and then later go back, once it was popular, and marketed as a second Mario game in the West, which was, by the way, re-released in Japan as Super Mario Bros. US version, what they call it, like US, and sold a ton. I mean, they loved it there, too. That version has become the sort of the real official canon version.
Now, was the whole thing reskinned so that it looked like Mario's World? With the clouds and the happy faces on the clouds and all of that?
No, that was already in there.
That was in there from the beginning.
They probably just changed the character sprites.
Yes. And the enemies, too. All the enemies were the same. And there were some slight differences with colors and things like that. But for the most part, it's all the same. The whole dream world, you know, the way that it works with you're able to jump on enemies, but they keep walking and you have to pick them up and that kind of stuff. All of that was still in there. It's just that they changed the characters so that, you know, they were Mario-related characters as opposed to this little, like, you know, Arabic family.
Yeah.
So, and there's also, interestingly, they added this thing where... something like the manual itself, the actual instruction manual, as you're reading through it in the original story, it kind of like cuts off at the end. And the idea when it talks about trying to defeat Big Boss Wart, and the cool idea they were going for was like, he had ripped that page out. It was like supposed to be this whole like meta theme. Mm-hmm. They went with Doki Doki Panic, and it kind of got lost in translation when they originally turned it into a Mario game. Kind of a whole thing. There's a lot of cool little facts about that game that are kind of neat.
Miyamoto is my Kojima.
Mm. Oh, I love Miyamoto. I absolutely adore him. He is my favorite game designer.
Yeah. Is he?
Eurogamer did an interesting thing recently where they brought in Miyamoto and I'm unfortunately forgetting the other guy's name, but another key designer on the original Super Mario Bros.
Probably Takeda?
Yeah, I think it was Takeda.
He was the other big guy on Mario Bros. Also did Zelda as well. Mm-hmm. Probably,
But they were kind of doing the rounds promoting Mario Maker, and they were talking about how they designed World 1-1. And it turns out they actually designed most of the rest of the game first and then came back to 1-1.
Mm-hmm.
And they were designing it very intentionally, not surprisingly, but they very intentionally designed things to ease the player into learning the game in this sort of very, we're not explaining it to you way, we're letting you learn the game yourself.
Right.
Which is something that a lot of other games take cues from.
That's excellent, because I actually had always kind of assumed that's what they had done, and I've talked about before, you know, I know when I was doing the game course as well, I would talk about, or the intro course in ATEG, I would always talk about that, I use that as my example, and talk about the way that it teaches you the mechanics and forces you to kind of learn as you know, the first part where the Goombas come in, and you know, you freak out, you hit jump, you hit the block, you kind of learn about breaking the block, and as you land, it kind of, you know, it's sort of set up to get you to kind of land on the Goomba and learn these different mechanics without being straight up told. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you have an instruction booklet as well, but, which is not key nowadays. Mm-hmm. If Mario was made nowadays, we'd have, obviously wouldn't, because Nintendo wouldn't do this, but a lot of games nowadays would have, like, a little text pop up. Mm-hmm. Oh, press the A button to jump.
It would pause.
It's BS. Yeah. So yeah, I love that sort of design. That's actually really cool that they made the whole game first and then went back and made that as almost like a demo level.
Yeah, I definitely recommend checking out that video because
that's pretty cool.
I don't want to explain the whole thing because it's just fun to hear them talk about it.
Yeah,
but, check out that article on Eurogamer, Miyamoto talking about World 1-1.
Nice. So many of the design decisions I think are fascinating. Like the choice for the red and blue was to do with the color palette, the limited color palette. They wanted something that would contrast with itself and also with the world behind it.
Yeah.
And that's why he's a plumber. I mean, it just kind of came down to that.
I think, have they ever confirmed, because there's been always these rumors that it was he was based on like a janitor at Nintendo that was Italian.
I don't know.
And they kept originally that had been like of Italian descent or something like that, and they were saying that was sort of the basis for the character. I know there had always been sort of, that was kind of like an urban legend kind of thing. I don't know if that had ever been confirmed.
I'd have to look that up.
I don't know.
But yeah, obviously, you know, Mario, so we've talked a lot about the original Mario Bros. Now, going around the table, have we all beaten the original Mario Bros.? Is it a fair assumption that we have?
I've not beaten it, actually. It's funny, because, again, like, I had played a little bit of Super Mario Bros., but it was because, like, I'd be going to, like, daycares and stuff like that where they happen to have a NES set up.
So did you never actually have Super Mario Bros. In your NES? Or you never had a NES?
I never had a NES. And I played either, like, at places like the daycares and stuff like that where you only, because you were just a kid, you, like, mastered like World 1-1 through World 1-3, but like never got beyond that, you know, that sort of deal.
So the thing about Mario 1, the original, and of course Lost Levels carries this over, which is the actual Super Mario 2 from Japan, which is more, really it's more like Super Mario Hard Mode, kind of like how Super Mario Galaxy 2 was Mario Galaxy 2, Mario Galaxy Hard Mode, rather. So that was what the real, like the Lost Levels was, that we know it here in the West. But both of those games had a very different jump mechanic and feel from the rest of the Mario series, and so it sometimes can be difficult to go back to it because of the way that it was set up.
That's actually my problem.
But honestly, it's if you go back and you take a little bit to get used to it, it actually is. It's still very, very like very tight controls.
Oh, I'm
not
sure
they're bad.
Yeah.
It's just it's different from what you're used to from that you get from Mario 2 onward. U.S. Mario.
I never really played much Mario 2. My first Mario game that I really got into and really played through, like I said, is Super Mario World, because my grandparents had it, and so when we'd go on vacation up in Ohio, whenever we weren't doing anything in particular, I'd just be playing on my grandpa's Super Nintendo. And I remember over one summer in particular when we were there for an extended stay, I used the Star Road shortcut. I sort of discovered that organically, and then got to the final level and got to the final boss fight, but I could never quite beat the final boss fight. I was just like, I didn't have the skill that comes with age, you know, to do that. And so to this day, I still actually haven't beaten Super Mario World. But it's definitely, because it was my first Mario game, I spent so much time with it, that is kind of like my standard for Mario. So that's why, you know, when I try to go back and play the original Super Mario Bros., well, I can definitely appreciate it in a lot of ways. I don't enjoy it quite as much because the feel is so different.
It is different. I mean, I think the feel, especially with Mario 3, Mario 3 kind of became... Because Mario 2 obviously was very different in terms of the way the game worked.
Oh, yeah.
So really, it was Super Mario Bros. 3 that has kind of been the benchmark for the rest of the series, the 2D series
true,
at
actually.
Least.
Yeah.
And of course, Super Mario World was basically a Super Nintendo version of Super Mario Bros. 3. I mean, I personally don't think the levels were quite as well designed, or the worlds were quite as distinct as they were in Super Mario Bros. 3. But it was still a very, it was still a good, I'm not going to say it wasn't a really good game. I just personally prefer Mario Bros. 3.
Sure. And I didn't play that much 3, so I think it has a lot to do, I think, with just kind of like what we...
They're pretty similar in a lot of ways, in terms, I mean, because they both have the Koopa Kids and that whole concept. So Koopa Kids, speaking of, are you pro or anti-Koopa Kid? Because I've heard some people say, and I kind of agree with it when I've heard these, is that it's kind of better that the series, and they've kind of gone back a little bit, but it's kind of better the series sort of dropped them because it allowed them to come up with more distinct bosses as opposed to just a variation of Bowser.
Sure, yeah, no, I agree.
But what do y'all think about the Koopa Kids?
I mean, I think that having them occasionally pop up is kind of fun. Like, you know, for instance, some of the new Super Mario Bros., the Wii and Wii U releases that have... And there's a reason they call it that, because it's hearkening back to, like, the old-school stuff, just with new graphics. So it makes sense that they're kind of going back to the Koopa Kids with those, but not necessarily all the other stuff.
And 3DS. And DS and all that,
But the idea that they're bringing them back for those, I think it makes sense. It's a little bit of a throwback. And you sort of get into this pattern of, here's basically how you defeat these bosses, and then maybe they'll throw some variant at you, you know, that sort of thing. But I think I do prefer when the bosses are more varied and, you know, very different.
Well, let me first assure you that the skill that comes with age also goes with age.
Yeah.
So there is that. But that said, the idea of different elements being in Mario, I think, is one of the strengths of the series.
Oh, yeah.
And I will actually contrast that with Zelda. One of my complaints about the recent Zeldas is that it feels like variations on a theme with Zelda. I have never felt that with Mario.
Oh, I agree.
I have always felt like each Mario entry was sufficiently innovative. Not a complete innovation. It's still a Mario game. It's still a platformer, and it's still whatever. But you know, some people pick up a certain entry and go, "Oh, that one was just terrible." And others, you know, you go, "Wow, this really is cool and innovative." Mm-hmm. And I think that that's continued throughout. I think when you look at the differentiation, like Mario Kart, to something like the Mystery Mansion or whatever that one was called.
Luigi's
Mansion, yeah.
Right, and we're going a little bit off track because those are technically...
Yeah, we're trying to focus on
more
Super Mario.
Yeah, those are more Mario spin-offs. But even within the franchise, I think what you said stands true.
It does.
Even within, if you're looking at something like Mario 64, Mario Bros. 3, or Super Paper Mario versus, I mean, it's different, or which is also a platform and I think applies here.
Yeah.
Or something like Mario Galaxy, Mario Sunshine. These are all... very different experiences in their own way. Mario Bros. 2 that we talked about for so long.
Speaking of which, one final deviation before we sort of stick to Super Mario Bros. I'm still holding out for Super Mario Golf Galaxy. Galaxy Golf.
With courses around the universe. That could be pretty cool. Because, you're playing in space.
Yeah, to be able to shoot a ball and actually have to worry about the orbit of something. It would totally innovate golf games in general, let alone Mario Golf. So I think that'd be pretty awesome.
It'd be as awesome as Angry Birds Space.
I never played awesome. Space. I did enjoy Angry Birds Star Wars,
though. And they used a similar mechanic, the gravity mechanic.
But yeah, I could totally see that. That is, that could actually be pretty cool. But yeah, so the most recent Mario game that has just come out would be Mario Maker, which kind of allows you to create your own Mario game.
Now, you've played that one, right, Chris?
I have not played it, but I've seen a bunch of people make stuff and play with it. Yeah. I do want to grab it at some point. What's interesting to me about Mario Maker, and I alluded to this earlier, is that I think it's Nintendo's way of themselves and their players being able to make just these crazy, super challenging courses, which people would do in the modding community anyway. You know, you'd have your sort of hacks of Super Mario that make all these crazy levels. But now you can actually do it in a licensed, official Mario game without necessarily scaring off audiences where if that was the designed experience... a lot of people would be turned off by it because it is so difficult.
Sure, yeah.
But now you can actually have, basically, I don't know what sort of curation there is really, but you can seek out either designers you like, you can sort of find a designer code or a course code. And if you're into the super challenging, crazy, what in the world is this sort of level, because you want to take your Mario skills and push them to the next level, you can totally do that. Or you can play the easier, almost more traditional, Nintendo designed style Mario levels. Which can have challenge, but are, obviously made to be doable.
Well, that's really popular right now. I've been looking for a long time to see the sort of Minecraft aesthetic come into what we might think of as mainstream games. And with Disney Infinity, of course, Infinity's been around for a while, and that sort of thing. I think we're beginning to really see that. And what was it, Skylanders before that and some of the other things. But I'm excited about this idea of crowdsourcing the content creation. I think that there was a bubble of it right up front about 10, 15 years ago.
Right.
And then it fell away.
Yeah, I was going to mention that too. Before pre-Minecraft, there was things like the Neverwinter Nights Aurora engine.
That's right.
Was pretty big in that. Or even going farther back, all of the Doom WoTs.
The Doom WoTs, yeah.
Huge, huge. And all those... that was a huge community. But like you said, it was big for a period, had a boom, both those did, and then it kind of dropped off.
I mentioned Spore, too, as being something that had lots of, crowdsourced content.
And now Little Big Planet.
Well, but that's more recent. That kind of fits in that wave of it coming back.
Yeah, I would say so. I would say a resurgence, maybe.
Part of that resurgence.
But regardless, the point is, I think it's great. I think that kind of design of here are the tools, we're giving them to you, play, release, enjoy.
And my impression, too, is that the UI and the way they let you design the levels is really... intuitive and really streamlined.
And that's important.
Yeah.
That's super important.
Well, that tablet, that's one of the advantages they have with that Wii U is you have that little tablet where you can just kind of essentially kind of almost draw your level in a way. So it kind of it really does, they really are taking advantage of the Wii U, right? That's kind of the whole point of it.
Does Wii U come with a stylus?
It does.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah. You can sit there. I've seen people play.
I haven't even put my hands on a Wii U, so.
And the sensitivity is such that if you need to, you can also get away. I don't use my finger, but you can use your finger, but I use, my fingernail, because it's pressure-based, and not, with an iPhone where it's, Well, I guess now there is pressure with iPhone 2, but
right.
It's not like based on just the electrical current hitting the screen. It's actually pressure-based.
Mm-hmm.
So you can use your finger if you don't have your stylus.
Okay.
That is pretty cool. And I do... So that's pretty interesting. So... Okay, so Mario Maker... In Mario Maker, you can use graphics from the original Super Mario Bros., Mario Bros. 3...
Mm-hmm.
And is there any? Is that? Is it just
I think
those
it's
two,
it's also Super Mario World.
Super Mario World. That makes
and
sense.
You can also do the new Super Mario Bros. Style,
so like
which
the,
is
the faux three, like not faux 3D. It's more like the 2.5D, where it's like it's 3D but in a 2D plane.
Yeah.
So can you do? But you can't do. You can't make your characters Super Mario Bros. 2 style.
Not that I'm aware of.
But do they? Do they have? They probably have those enemies, right? Like Shy Guys or something, or not.
That I'm not sure about. I'd have to look that up.
What if I want to have make a level that is nothing but you facing Big Boss Wart over and over again?
I don't know if they have Big Boss Wart in there, but you could make a level where you face Bowser over and over
But Big Boss Wart.
People have done that, in fact, where it's like just a tower of Bowsers.
Big Boss Wart was the scariest thing because the only way you could beat him is by feeding him vegetables. It's like as a kid, you're like, whoa, this is kind of scary.
The ultimate weapon.
Vegetables.
it's reinforcing bad perceptions of vegetables among children. So
there we go. Yeah, I mean, I don't know if we really need to go around and talk about first Mario experiences because it's kind of, I would imagine all of us played the original first, or at least I know you talked about Mario World, but I know we've all experienced the original Super Mario Brothers.
I have to say, I actually, as much as I do like the 2D Marios, I think I personally prefer the 3D.
Mm-hmm.
And while 64 doesn't age quite as well as one might hope, I think it's still a pretty solid game. But things like Galaxy and stuff like that, I think I do overall like the style of the 3D just a little bit more than
the 2D. I love them both, to be perfectly honest.
Oh, no, I love them
both,
offer, too. Yeah.
They offer something different, and both of them do, the different styles. And I'm probably going to have to go with Galaxy for the 3D experience, but it's not that I didn't enjoy 64, it's just... To me, it didn't... I know that all Mario games kind of have a slightly different feel, but it didn't feel like enough of a Mario game. It felt like it wasn't really a platformer. It came across as more of an adventure game.
Mm-hmm.
Because they were experimenting with that. And of course, it was also an extremely influential game. It basically, you know, there was 3D. Developers could now make games in 3D, and none of them knew what the heck they were doing.
That's true.
None of them could do it. They all... were terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, Miyamoto and Takeda, again, they got together and a bunch of other, you know, people working at Nintendo, and Super Mario 64 was sort of the template for 3D games, and that was what had been used. And of course, you know, with Ocarina of Time and Zelda, that as well did a lot of stuff in terms of influence on, like, action, more action-oriented 3D games. But, but yeah, like, the full open 3D world experience... Mario 64.
Yep.
Super Mario 64 is what we have to thank for it, even though I personally think it's, if you're looking overall at the 3D Mario games, I think it is one of the weaker ones, but a lot of that has to do with
it. It was the first, the very first. Important first step into a whole new dimension, literally.
Yeah.
Literally.
And so that's pretty cool. And this series is really full of these sorts of innovations that have been, you know, consistently sort of copied and taken by others. A lot of that gravity switching stuff and moving around and the way that Galaxy sort of played around with that, I know I've seen that kind of crop up in other games as well. And the way that it sort of was already there for 2D, a lot of 2D games, especially back on the NES, it sort of played around with gravity, like the Gravity Man stage for Mega Man 5 or Metal Storm, where you're like this little mech switching gravity. So there's 2D games that played around with it, but in terms of 3D and playing around with that theme in a platformer, Galaxy was very innovative in that sense. And I had not, to my knowledge, there had not been another game that had really been able to pull that off.
Well,
3D.
What Mario does that's really impressive, and it's something that carries over in a lot of other Nintendo properties and what makes them one of my favorite designers overall, is their mastery of the game feel. Both in 2D and in 3D. Like, they talked even, like I mentioned the Eurogamer thing, they talked a little bit about the slide that Mario has in Super Mario Brothers. First, I'm sure a ton of effort went into, like, getting the feel of the jumps right and that sort of thing. But they were talking about, when they were thinking about it, it never made sense to them if a 2D figure that's supposed to be, in theory, a 3D thing with some weight is just kind of able to be like perfectly controlled and completely nimble. And so what they were sort of imagining is, for example, you turn around, if you were turning around in real life, and of course it's abstracted a bit, but you'd have to stop and actually turn, almost making like a little
kind of a hairpin
sort of shape to turn yourself around, especially if you're running. And that's basically what's happening. And so they abstract that in the 2D by having the little slide and coming to a stop and having to re-accelerate. It gives your 2D character this feeling of weight. And they've carried that over into the 3D stuff, and they've perfected it over the years. The game feel, the sense of having just the right amount of control over your character, that it feels right, you know? It's kind of hard to put into words, but game feel is an extremely important thing about platformers that Nintendo's always been extremely good at.
You know, it's funny you mention that, because one of the complaints that I have about these retro style games is that they don't always account for that.
I completely agree, and I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah,
I agree with you.
Like you, it is funny actually now that you mention it, because that's one of the things that bugs me about some of them, is that I see a certain thing, and so I almost expect to feel a certain thing when I play,
right?
And it doesn't feel that way.
Yeah. In fact, that's one of the problems that I had with our recent retro game that we did. What was it called?
Axiom Verge.
Yeah, is that I had trouble staying on the block.
Yeah,
I would fall off a lot.
Yeah, I think, and you know, not to get too far off into Metroid, but I think Metroid does a better job of, you know, control wise the way, again, like you said, a Nintendo designed game, but giving you that sort of like feel of weight to your character. And then also the Mario games as well do something really, another thing really well, which I thought you were about to go into, but I agree with you with the weight thing. But also just, you know, the focus, like the Super Mario games, they know what sort of game they're trying to make. I mean, it's different for each one to an extent, but they know what they're doing, and they keep with their theme, and they don't try to have all this
feature creep
what Doc referred to it as well. But they're not trying to just do everything under the sun. Like, they know what they're doing, and they're focused.
The other thing that's interesting, too, is that with Mario's rich history, like, how many different power-ups has Mario had over the years, right?
Yeah.
And yet any given game only has a set of, like, say, five.
Right.
Maybe, give or take a little bit. But, like, there's certain things that, like, tend to always be there. For example, the mushroom in a 2D game.
Mm-hmm.
Even the green mushroom appears in the 3D games.
Yeah. Like fire, the Fire Mario and the Invincible Star, you know, Invincible Mario.
They're iconic.
Those are the two that I think have been used probably the most, I would assume.
Yeah, and like kind of appearing in everything, but at the same time, like, you know, take the new Super Mario Bros. For example. They make like a new power up, and instead of having like, hey, Mario's had like all these 20 different power ups, you can get all 20 power ups in this game. It's more like, no, here are the five in this game, and we're going to design levels around these five. Which I think is a smart move, because if you tried to design a level to be able to handle every single power-up in the game, it's either going to be way overcomplicated, or it's just going to feel very bland, because they kind of need to make it simple to fit everything, you know?
I also love how whenever a Mario game, and this is apparent in both the 2D and the 3D ones, whenever they give you a new, introduce a new power-up, in that first level when you get it, like, for, like, I mean, going all the way back to, like, say, like, Yoshi and Mario in Super Mario World, or we're talking about in, say, Galaxy, when you first get the spring, or the bee suit, things like that. When you first use these power-ups, they have, the first level you get it in is almost like the, you know, demo or tutorial level for it. Without it feeling like a tutorial level, it feels really fun.
Yeah.
But it introduces you to this power-up in a way that helps you understand how to use it and when it's best used, and its purpose and all that. Without feeling like you're being coddled, without feeling like it has to sit there and give you this long, you know, lines of text and explain, well, here's the bee suit, and you can sort of fly for a little bit, but then you're going to fall, and if you don't want to touch water, because then you'll lose your suit. It doesn't need to do that. It just kind of gives you all these experiences that put you into situations where you're probably going to experience those problems, but then they also give you a chance to get the power up back.
Yeah, it's kind of
experimenting with it.
Yeah, let you fail in kind of a safe place, and then raise the stakes once you've kind of gotten to the point of mastery.
Oh yeah,
it's good design.
Yeah,
Very, very flow theory, I think.
And I think the Super Mario Bros. Series, that's something I think that they are the strongest at, is that. And I think that's why they are a benchmark and such an iconic series in video games, and why so many games have tried to emulate the series in so many different ways, some more successful than others. Okay, so I know we've gone pretty long. I don't know if I don't know if it's really worth going around and talking about our most favorite Mario game.
About Mario Memory.
Mario Memory, there we go. Okay, Mario Memory. Doc, do you have a good Mario Memory you'd like to share?
I do, actually. Yeah, before my granddad died, he actually played quite a lot of Mario on the original Nintendo. We got him one. He called it the Jumping Man game, which is kind of interesting considering his original name was Jumpman.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, he was pretty good. He used to get up to level 4, 5, 6, I don't know, and all kinds of things. He knew what the warps were. One of my fondest memories is... with him is explaining to him how it worked and playing it with him and trading the controller back and forth and back and forth. That was really cool.
Yeah, for me, I guess I have, I have so many Mario memories, but I guess one that really does stick with me, I guess, it would be the very first, just because that was the first game I played on my NES. So it was kind of a special thing where when I first got the NES and experienced, you know, a video game of my own. It completely blew me away. The only experience in video games that I'd had prior to that was playing, Atari 2600, at a friend's place. I played, I believe it was Millipede. It's probably my first video game. And you compare that experience to Super Mario Brothers, it's like night and day. It was like, whoa, we can do this with video games?
Mm-hmm.
And look at these graphics. It's like I'm really there, you know. It's it was incredible. No, for its time, I mean, the colors, you know, of course, were totally different from what we had experienced. And yes, like the controls, like you said, I mean, it really, you feel like you are, like this character, the sort of control that you have with it, yes, because you don't have such perfect control, it makes you feel like you are in control of the character.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I think that, to me, was just... really stands out. The other one would be probably Super Mario Bros. 2, just because that was another one that I played a lot with my grandfather. He knew that I had the original, so he bought Super Mario Bros. 2 and didn't have the original. He just had 2. So when I went over to his place, that's what we would play. It's like, here's Super Mario Bros. 2. I'm like, there's a 2? You know, so it was one of those experiences where, and it was so different. So that too, like that was also when I kind of learned, wow, these games are just totally night and day different. But so much fun.
Yeah. I think for me, when I first was playing Super Mario 64, I was at a friend's house. Like, he lived like 4 houses down the street, and so we would hang out all the time. And he was definitely much more of an outdoors kid than I was. So I would often be pestering him. It's like, hey, you want to go inside and play some video games? He's like, no, let's keep like, you know, playing street hockey or whatever. I'm like, all right. And so I'd kind of like put up with it for the chance to be able to go inside and play Mario.
Fake an injury and go inside. Just
nah,
like, you blew your chance.
I wouldn't be surprised if that happened once or twice. I was very young. I think I was kind of at that sweet spot age-wise where you play a video game and it's not a video game. You know, you are Mario. And
yeah.
64, you mentioned the kind of the adventure aspect. I think that's one of the things that charmed me about it so much is I felt like I was Mario stuck in this castle on this quest to save the princess, you know, and... like really getting into exploring all the levels. Like we would take our sweet time with the levels. We'd play the same levels over and over and over again because like, you know, we couldn't beat them that easily. And so like we'd like slowly master each world and then kind of like move on to the next little world and that sort of thing. And that was really awesome, that exploration. I remember one of the favorite things I had about that game was one, the sliding levels where you got to sort of like slide down the
down little like ice sort of thing where you're going to like the mountain.
Yeah, there's the ice one and there are like the secret levels in the castle where you do that.
Yeah.
And the secret rooms, and of course they were in real levels too, but the secret rooms where, for instance, you'd go into the lobby and look up into the light in the ceiling, and you'd go into the secret level where you have the wing cap. And you're able to fly around. And I was like super into like planes and flying and stuff like that. So being able to sort of fly with, you know, plane like controls as Mario in the game, even though it was a temporary power up, it would go away after a little while. That was just a blast. So I think, you know, fondest memories of Mario probably have to be in 64 for me.
Cool.
Very nice. I never could beat that one level with the ducks where the dog pops up and he's supposed to shoot him. I could never shoot that stupid dog.
That's a whole other experience. I gotta tell you.
Oh, was it?
I was just gonna say.
It's on the same disc.
Yeah. I was just gonna say that was a whole other thing because my grandfather was so freaking good at that game. He embarrassed me. He would sit as far as you could and he would hit like every freaking duck. I was, yeah. Anyway, that's a whole other talk.
But this dog is mocking me.
Well, it must be time to go because the music is playing.
Yes.
Well, thank you everyone for joining us for episode number 45 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us about your favorite Super Mario title and why it ranks highest for you. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible.
Charles Martinet, if you decided to join us, we never plug Charles Martinet, right? The voice of Mario.
Yeah, cool guy.
That's fine. He's actually really cool.
Yeah.
I've never actually met him personally, but I've seen him in other places.
The stories I hear about him are always very positive. Yeah. Like, he's totally willing to play along and to do the voice and whatnot.
He's pretty old now, isn't he?
Probably, yeah.
Isn't he? I thought he was in like his late 60s, maybe even 70s.
He's the alternative.
Well, yeah. Being young, it sucks.
No.
I know what you mean.
Dead, I meant dead.